Welcome to r/legaladvice, where we read surprisingly interesting stories that don't end in a cliffhanger, I promise. If you are new around here, please feel free to subscribe to join our awesome community, and without any further ado, let's dive right in. My old babysitters won't leave me and my child alone. Please forgive me if this does not make any sense. I'm kind of enraged at the moment, so my mind is all over the place. My son's old babysitters, who were friends at the time and were trusted, had guardianship over him in case of medical emergencies while he was in their care while I worked. I stopped working 2 years ago, almost three, and told them I would no longer need them to watch my child since we were planning to move to a different state anyway, and I ended their guardianship after they tried to keep my son from me and told him that he could live with them forever and that I never wanted or loved him like they do. Since stopping their guardianship, they have followed us around grocery stores, comes up and stops us in stores and tries to force my child to come to them. And when he doesn't, they will cry and make a scene, message me consistently about when they could have him, kept and continue posting about how much they miss my child, ask my family members, mainly my sister, if they can see him or how he is doing or if my family can send them pictures of my son. Even asking them numerous times to stop and just leave us alone, they still continue to do these things. It's getting to the point where I have to avoid certain parts of the county that we live in just to stay away from them. If they see that I'm tagged somewhere on Facebook by a friend, they will show up even if it is 30 plus minutes away. So my question is, what can I do at this point? I'm pretty sure this falls under harassment considering I have asked them to stop trying to contact me or my child, but I'm still not 100% sure on what exactly I can do. Any advice would be greatly appreciated, located in Maryland. ETA, my son is currently in the process of going to therapy because he's scared that they are gonna try to take him away again. There was one point in time that they took him out of the county for a week and would not let me get my child. Since they had guardianship, they told me they were allowed to take him without my consent and there was nothing I could do about it. When I finally got him back after the week was over, I cut contact and went and filed to end their guardianship. I have to admit, it sounds extremely dangerous to give guardianship to someone even if they are trusted friends. Have you ever given guardianship of your kids to someone outside of your family? Feel free to let us know in the comments. Update: my old babysitters won't leave me and my child alone. So it has been a while, but I really wanted to update since a lot of people on the original post were concerned. Also, sorry for the bad format, I usually just comment on posts and don't post a lot, so I'm clueless. Anyway, so I had contacted a lawyer about the potential kidnappers, because that's what they are, not really babysitters, and I found out they lied to me for a year or two about having guardianship of my son. This was explained in the original post, but brief rundown about it was they requested guardianship to be able to take him to the hospital for treatment if anything happened in their care. Being young and dumb, I agreed. Apparently, the courts never pushed it through because they did not contact my son's biological father after being told they needed to do that. I did not know any of this until about a month ago after the lawyer had dug up a bunch of stuff. They lied about having guardianship and held it over my head in order for me to not come pick my son up from their care and so they would take him out of the county slash state without my consent. Anyway, they are currently going through court for potentially trying to kidnap someone else's kid after being paid to watch the second child. Apparently, they filed for emergency custody of the second child after not allowing the mother to come pick up their child. Since it is an ongoing case, I cannot give too many details about it, but I am being called in as a witness for their obsessive behavior and manipulation tactics. They are no longer allowed to contact me, my child, or any family members about myself and my child. So the lesson we learned today is to never give guardianship to anyone outside of your own family. I found out I had a child when CPS contacted me because her mother was losing custody. Now what? To make a long story short, I was a person who loved happy pills and as a result did a lot of dumb, questionable things. I've been clean for 11 years now. About a week and a half ago, I was contacted by CPS, who asked if I knew Mary Smith, a woman with whom I had a relationship when I was on drugs. I said yes and was informed that she had a child, Emma last name, who had been taken from the home and I was named as her father. With no other contactable family, she could come to me or otherwise go to foster care. It was relayed to me that I was listed as the child's father on her legal documents as well. To cut out some bullcrap from the middle here, I will just skip to the fact that I did accept emergency custody of the child and I do actually pretty strongly believe that I'm probably her biological father for a number of reasons, but I feel like at this point the caseworkers have been unhelpful and are basically like, for all intents and purposes, you are her legal father, bye, and not answering my questions. Emma apparently knew I existed and was told through her life that I was her father, but her mother said she had no way of contacting me, which I guess is technically true. My questions: how was I listed on the birth certificate, legal records, school records, etc., and literally never informed ever at any point? How is this possible? Number 2, the caseworker said that because I am on the birth certificate, and the undertone here was,
unless you have an identical twin somewhere, that is 100% your child.
There's no need to take a DNA test. Is there any benefit to doing so? And the third one, this one I may have to consult with a lawyer on, but if I am her father, am I then entitled to child support? Or the foster care stipend? That sounds terrible, but I don't make a lot of money and I am stressed because there's times I feel like I'm not sure if I'm going to have enough for myself even working full time, and I need to be able to provide for a kid now as well. It's not about the money, but it is a little bit about the money. Update to the story from before, nearly 3 months later, about the kid I did not know existed for 10 years. It has been almost 3 months now and I thought I would come in real quick to give an update. Overall, the kid and I are doing great. I really expected the adjustment period to suck, but I feel like maybe this poor kid really needed some structure and stability and totally gloomed onto that. I tried to just give her as much of my love, patience, structure and stability that I have to give. I've been learning a lot about attachment, trauma and everything. It has been overwhelming, but every night, no matter how exhausted I am, I get into bed and I thank God for her. I would not trade her for anything in this world. I tell her every night she is my favorite thing. Legally, things are kind of boring. I did the DNA test, unsurprisingly got the result that she is mine biologically. The emergency order is still in place, head mom is still in jail, she was offered the option of going to rehab and refused. She will be in jail for at least a few more months, and after she's out we will make a parenting plan for visits with help from the social worker. Realistically, I think she will die before she gets clean. That sounds like a horrible thing to say, but it is how it is. It has been a wild ride, it's not easy, but it's joyful and it's really changed my life and made me want to be better in a lot of ways. That was actually a very surprisingly wholesome story in the end, and please let me know in the comments if you enjoy r/legal advice. Furthermore, if you have watched until here, please don't forget to post some star emojis in the comments and also like the video if you want to support me. Thank you very much. Received a reckless driving ticket on my private property road/driveway. Before anyone gets upset about the speed, this is a gated off private road/driveway. There was zero chances of another car being on it unless they broke through a locked gate and trespassed on clearly marked private property. So my driveway is in a weird spot that goes alongside a highway for about 4 miles before turning off and up towards the house. The entire property is fenced off and gated/posted private property, no trespassing. It is about 800 feet from the highway and slowly moves further and further from the highway. I use my driveway as a place to work out kinks in my cars, get them set up properly, etc., before going to the drag strip. I love cars and try to do things as safely as possible, roll cages, proper harnesses and helmet, etc. I never open them up on the road because I have no need to, I can do it on my own private property. Anyways, last night I was having fun with my newly broken in engine swapped car. doing a few runs back and forth, and after the 6th or 7th run down, I notice a cop with lights on sitting down at the gate. I head down and tell him I will be right back. I have to go get the key to the gate, but he insists I stay there. So I stay and he demands license, registration and insurance. I tell him I have none of those on me and the car is not even registered or insured. I bring it to and from the track slash strip on a trailer. I tell him this because the car is not even street legal and it is a track car. So he just gets my information from my name, DOB, address, etc. I ask him why he's even here, because this is not a road, why is he stopping me? He tells me reckless driving and he has me on laser doing 162. I start to argue that this is a private road slash driveway, clearly because he is sitting behind a locked gate and how can I be recklessly driving on private property? He starts telling me I can go to jail if I keep arguing. After about 20 minutes of just standing at my gate, he gives me a ticket to sign for reckless driving. The ticket does not even have a posted speed for the road on it because this is not a road. What do I need to bring to the court date to show this is not a road and he has no jurisdiction to enforce traffic laws on? I am not trying to cause a huge issue, but it is kind of stupid. He even gave me a ticket. I did not feel like continuing to argue with him because it was going nowhere. I live in Texas and the sheriff's department is who wrote the ticket. Guys, have you ever received a reckless driving ticket? I'm not sure how you guys drive cars, but in general, I drive pretty slow, so I don't have an issue with speeding tickets. Let me know how it is for you. Update to the story from before, received a reckless driving ticket on private property. Before my court date came up, I went around to the different county records offices and found an up-to-date plat map, confirmed with several people that my driveway is not a road. I even had a friend come by who usually does drone photos for farms and had a nice photo of the entire property taken, showing the driveway with a GPS marker so that it can be lined up with the plat map so there's no confusion if my driveway is or is not a road. 2 days before my court date, I received a call asking if I want to take a deal on the reckless driving and avoid the court time, etc. I said no and confirmed the date with them. Court date rolls around and my 10:30 a.m. time is just an estimate apparently, so I wait around until 2 p.m. right before I am finally called up. I'm offered the deal one last time, again I decline. This is where it gets odd. I'm not 100% sure what happened, but the judge opens a folder and briefly reads it, then calls up the county attorney. They talk for about a minute, then my case is dismissed. So that's it. I asked the sheriff outside the courtroom if it is possible to talk to the judge about it, and I am told the best way is to write him a letter. Not sure what he read in the folder, but I guess it was enough for him to see it was a pointless ticket. I did not see the sheriff who wrote me the ticket anywhere either that day. So I guess we did hit Reddit or something, who knows, but now I get the fun of trying to figure out what my insurance wants as proof so my rates don't jump because of the ticket. By the way guys, one question I have about American highways. You know, whenever I see vlogs of people riding motorcycles in America, I'm thinking, wow, these people drive pretty slow considering that the roads are so huge and there doesn't seem to be any police anywhere. But then, seemingly out of nowhere, the highway police comes and stops the biker. How frequently do you guys see police on the highway? And the next story is not from r/legaladvice, but instead from our own subreddit, just to bring in a little bit of variety. This story was posted by user StacyRosesMe and is titled Walmart Adventure with a Service Dog. So this morning at about 5 a.m. I decided to head to Walmart with my friend who happens to have a service dog. Normally when we go there together, we never have an issue. Plus, this Walmart seems to allow all dogs, even the ones that are not service animals, even though the sign out front says that only service animals are allowed in the store. But I have seen people in there many times with many breeds of dogs, some well behaved and some that bark and jump on people. And yet, the people at Walmart never ever say anything to those people, so what happened today baffled me and my friend, but it had nothing to do with the employees themselves, just a random jerk. So we get in the store and my friend's service dog is trained to task whenever my friend is about to have an episode. Basically, my friend has severe seizures, and if she's about to have a seizure, Max, her service dog, will task. He will put his paws on her or nudges her leg to let her know she's gonna have a seizure. We had just walked in the store when Max started tasking, so my friend sat down on the floor before she had a seizure. Max laid himself down on top of her, which he's supposed to do, but some random jerk started yelling and trying to pull Max off my friend. I looked at this guy and said, "Leave him alone, he's tasking." And the jerk said,
"Dogs don't lay on people."
And I said, "He is a service dog and he's doing what he's supposed to do. If you interfere with his tasking, you are breaking the law." And the jerk started laughing and said,
"What law?"
So I explained the American Disability Act, ADA, and explained how you are never supposed to interfere with service dogs because it could be dangerous to the person who is disabled. Mr. Jerk then went off on me, telling me, "I don't know what I'm talking about," and I simply said, "I do know if you continue to interfere with my friend's service dog, I will call the police, so you decide, what are you gonna do?" Meanwhile, during all this, my friend is still on the ground. She's not able to say anything because basically she had passed out. She had a seizure while on the ground, and that is why Max was laying on top of her. He's supposed to do that because it has something to do with applying pressure on his master. Mr. Jerk stormed off somewhere, I'm not sure where, but I did not care. I was staying by my friend and Max. A few people had circled us asking me what was going on, so I explained to them and they completely understood. The door greeter stayed by us to make sure nobody interfered also. Very great guy. By the time Mr. Jerk came back, my friend was already coming too and Max was sitting by her. My friend was a bit dazed, but she was okay. Mr. Jerk looked at my friend and said,
"Your stupid dog was on top of you. That's not what service dogs do."
My friend looked at him and said, "My service dog was doing his job. That is what he's supposed to do." So Mr. Jerk looked at the manager that he dragged with him and said,
"That's a fake service dog."
The manager did not say a word. So Mr. Jerk started asking my friend a whole crap load of questions that is basically invasive. So my friend simply said, "You are only allowed to ask me 2 questions regarding my service dog." Mr. Jerk scoffed and said,
"Oh yeah? What is that?"
So the dog greeter said, "You can only ask, is that a service dog, and what tasks does your dog perform for you?" The manager nodded with agreement and told the jerk to leave us alone. The guy started going off and saying how he is gonna call the police on us for having a fake service dog, so my friend said, "Go ahead." The manager looked at the guy and said,
"Sir, you need to leave. Stop harassing these girls and their service dog, or you need to leave the store."
The manager had said something I did not catch in the little walkie-talkie thingy, and soon there were 2 guys there that I knew were security, aka loss prevention. Apparently, this jerk was actually caught on camera for a very long time, and during the time my friend was having a seizure, he was trying to get out of the store with some DVDs he was trying to steal. They were hidden inside his jacket. It was pretty bold of him to go get the manager and try to play like he was not doing anything wrong at all. Basically, he knew he was being watched, but was trying to get the attention off him and have it on my friend, myself and Max. It did not work. Mr. Jerk was asked to follow the 2 security guys back to the office, and this was when all hell broke loose. Mr. Jerk started screaming, yelling, name-calling, and he was throwing things at anyone nearby. The door greeter moved in front of my friend, who was still on the floor, to basically protect her and Max. A bunch of other people, including myself, were standing in front of my friend also. This jerk did not like that we were all standing there to protect a person he thinks has a service dog. During all this commotion, the police did show up. The manager checked on everyone to see if they were okay and asked my friend if she needed a few more minutes. My friend thanked the manager and door greeter for helping out, and she thanked the people that stood around. Max, of course, was given a treat by my friend for doing his job. We did get to finally do our shopping, which was very calm compared to what happened when we just came into the store. When we were cashing out, everything had calmed down and the manager came over to us to apologize again for what happened. The manager also asked if my friend had some information sheets he could share with his employees because he wants them trained right when it comes to ADA and service dogs. My friend was very happy to give him some of the cards she carries around with her that were in Max's service vest. She also told him that if he needs more, where he can get them, and he thanked her. We did not bother asking what happened to the jerk because we figured he got arrested for theft and whatever else. Okay, I know some are gonna ask questions about Max. He is a German Shepherd and very beautiful. My friend has had him since he was a puppy. My friend had help training him to be a service dog. He is like her baby. She loves him and is very glad she got approved for a service dog. Max is about 3 years old, not sure what that is in dog years. Anyway, he is very well trained. Also, if you see someone with a service dog, you should never ever distract them from their task. You should never pet a service dog unless the owner says it's okay. Some people have signs on their service dog's vests that say, "Service dog, do not pet." But also, service dogs do not have to wear a vest. If you need to understand more about service dogs, you can easily find whatever information you need online. Have a good morning, everyone. I am now home drinking tea and watching some Studio Ghibli movies. I think I will use Entitled People as a flair, since that jerk was entitled. Well, Stacy, thank you very, very much for posting that story. And actually, I think I have mentioned this before, my girlfriend's mother has a problem with seizures, so maybe a service dog would be a good thing for her. But of course only if that is a thing in Thailand. Let's move on to the last story, which is also from r/ripe stories. The last one was posted by Real Farfall Alfredo and is titled "How I Got a Former SM Demoted." The story today about the liquor store worker reminded me of the time I got a SM demoted. I worked for a Midwest grocery/drug combo chain. I worked as receiving clerk and supervisor for the drug chain. Since I was coming up on 10 years with the same company, I had done almost every job in the store except for liquor clerk and management. However, I could do management jobs also. I started working there just after divorcing my ex-husband. A few months into my employment, I started going back to church with my sister and her family. My manager at the time had no problem adjusting my availability to give me Sundays off to go to church and Wednesday nights for Bible study. There is a law in the US that employers cannot discriminate based on religion and must give time off to worship. The accommodation carried over when I moved and transferred stores. When I became receiving clerk, my work hours were when receiving was open, usually 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m., minus 30 minutes for lunch. Being a supervisor, I was required to work at least one weekend day, which was Saturday when I worked a closing shift and I was off Sunday for church. Retail stores rotate managers very often, and it was rare that we had the same management longer than a year. Corporate sent us a manager trainee, so fresh out of business school, the ink was barely dry on her degree. She had almost zero experience in actually running a store, just what she learned in business school. One of the first things she did was get rid of everybody's availability sheets and accommodations, saying we would be available when the store needed us. We ended up losing good workers because she was basically forcing them to work when they couldn't. She was scheduling high school kids during school hours, scheduled retirees at full-time hours. Some of them would lose their retirement benefits if they worked over a certain number of hours. And she scheduled me during church time. For almost a month, I was trading hours with my co-workers, so we would all be working within our availability and telling the manager trainee that we could not work those hours, only to get the response of,
"Everybody works when needed. If they don't like it, they can leave."
Spoiler alert, a lot left. New schedule was posted, and again, I am scheduled during my church time. I printed out the law saying I got time off to attend church and handed it to the assistant and told her that I would not be working outside my availability and original accommodation. She did not even read the printout, instead tore it up and said the same,
"If you don't like it, you can leave."
So I took off my name tag, put it in her hand and said, "Bye," and walked out. When I got home, I filed for unemployment and filed a complaint with the EEOC, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the US agency that covers discrimination complaints, stating that my 9-year accommodation for church was rescinded without notice and I was also denied being promoted into the manager training program because of my lack of Sunday availability. Of course, they tried to say I was fired due to job abandonment and disputed unemployment, I won after the store manager admitted that I brought up the scheduling problems to her and she did nothing. And lost the EEOC claim because the store claimed I did not fill out a form requesting an accommodation, the same one the trainee threw out. And since I did not keep a copy, unfortunately not being able to see 9 years into the future, thinking I would eventually need it, however, because she was named in the complaint and since the store got complaints from other employees who quit due to her scheduling practices and her refusal to accommodate anybody, the trainee was demoted to a regular sales clerk and later left the company. I know this because I kept in touch with the assistant manager who was at the store before she was. Every store was sent a directive from corporate that they were to accommodate every religious time of request. For the record, yes, I did go to the store manager. At the time, the store had just been sold to a new banner corporation and was in the process of restructuring. Her job was being made redundant. They did not see the need for 2 store managers, one over drug and one over food, and since she was losing her job anyway, she adopted a
"don't give a damn"
attitude and was very hands off. I think she spent most of her time updating her resume and looking for another job. Thank you very much for posting this fantastic Tales from Retail story, but unfortunately my mouth is now so dry I need to stop reading for today. I'm very sorry guys, but I hope you enjoyed the content today, especially because it was a little bit different, so please let me know in the comments if you enjoy r/legal advice or not. I know in the past some of you complained that the legal advice stories are good, but they kind of end nowhere. There's always a cliffhanger. So I thought the solution to that is to simply read stories that also got an update. Please let me know what you think about that. Either way, thank you very much for watching and I hope you have a fantastic day and I see you again tomorrow.